Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Andri Setiawan, and I'm the secretary of FIB Young Members Group International. And it's my pleasure this afternoon to welcome all of you here in this webinar series. The title of the webinar presentation today is the application of microbes to improve the performance of high volume coal ash concrete. And I will introduce you also later with the main speaker, Dr. Eng Januarti Jaya Eka Putri. But before we move on to the main webinar, I want to present you a bit more about the Young Members Group and also about some general rules about this webinar event. So first of all, about the next event. The next event of FIB will be the symposium in Lisbon, which will be held in Lisbon, Portugal between 14 to 16 of June. So I think the registration for the paper is already being closed, but if you are interested to join as a participant, you can still visit the website and register, and the symposium will be held also fully online. And then about the Young Members Group, there will be also event in that symposium related to specifically about the Young Members Group. The Young Members Group activities is organized by young engineers and some young academicians as well. And it was established in Madrid in 2017. And since then, we had also several events. The one of the first involvement that I had was the symposium in Prague, which was in 2018. And after that, we had another meeting, like an annual meeting in every symposium. So you are more than welcome if you are interested to join with the FIB Young Members Group. And if you are interested, you can connect with us through the Facebook. We have our Facebook group, so you can find us there and then connect with us, or you can also visit us in the FIB website. There is a specific section there for the Young Members Group, and you can find our activities and the members and everything that you want to see there. And now let me kindly introduce our main speaker today, Ibu Januarti Jaya Eka Putri. So she had a PhD degree from in civil engineering from the University of Tokyo in Japan. And she is the director of Indonesian Geopolymer. And she's a vice president of Asia Pacific Women Inventors and Innovator Network. And she's an associate professor at 10 November Institute of Technology, Surabaya, Indonesia. And she had several awards. The one of them is the best researcher in Indonesia in 2017. And her research interests are geopolymer, concrete durability, green concrete, and coal ash characterization. And her involvement in FIB, she is the deputy of national delegation in FIB Indonesia, and she is also the member of Task Group 7.1 related to sustainable concrete. I will give the stage and time for Dr. Januarti Jaya Eka Putri to present her materials. Thank you very much.
Good evening, everyone. Good afternoon. It is already 10 p.m. in Indonesia. Thank you, YMG, FIB, especially Andri, for the invitation to share my experiences in green concrete. My name is Januarti from ITS Surabaya. Tonight, let's discuss about collaborations between mechanical, physical, chemical, and biological process of green concrete containing microbes. Let's see the recent data of Indonesian government plan in 2020 to 2024. To increase the national energy supply, there was a target to reach 35 gigawatt. It implicated the composition of the source of the energy, as it's easier to use coal-fired power plants because we have the coal. Then the power plant ratio has increased from only 53% in 2015 to more than 60% in 2024. Of course, this makes another problem on coal ash management. The utilization of Indonesian coal ash It's very much less than other countries like United States and China and India. Of course, compared to Japan, where collage is utilized almost 100%. So we have also another problem on environment, as reported in 2018 by Ministry of Environment and Forestry. Total emissions is dominated by many sectors, including concrete industry. Here we face some problems to be solved. We must decrease the greenhouse emissions and consider the environmental problems in Indonesia and subtropical countries. During summer, hot weather becomes a problem of shrinkage, and also because of the hot weather, the early cracks occur. As we are in the tropical and have a very long coastline, durability issue is also the additional problem. Let us see closer what we have in collage. We have SEM analysis and some pictures of the collage. According to STMC 618, fly ash is classified as class C and class F. For some characterizations, they can be used as pozzolan or cementitious materials to replace cement. However, bottom ash has a rough particles and non-reactive. It can be used as sand replacement in concrete mixture. Then, what happens if we use pozzolan in concrete? And yes, pozzolan can create a better concrete during the hydrogen reactions after cement contact with water. Besides calcium silicate hydride, here in green, portlandite or calcium hydroxide is formed and exists in concrete pores. This calcium drawn in red here react with alumina and silica in concrete to fill the pores. This is why at the later age, concrete containing fly ash shows the development of strength, while normal concrete shows almost constant strength after 28 days. Fly ash also can decrease the hydration temperature. It increases also concrete durability and makes concrete easy to cast. From this point, we have a challenge to utilize more fly ash in concrete. Of course, this is not an easy task. Then let me show our previous experience on making high volume fly ash, where fly ash replace the cement up to 70%. In normal strength, around 25 to 30 megapascal, hydration temperature decreases about 10%. In higher cement content, replacing fly ash to 50% can decrease the temperature around 20%. This is a very good start. However, as fly ash content increases, the water demand in the mixture is also becomes higher. Besides that, pH of fly ash is always lower than cement. This causes a low rate of reactivity during hydration process. And we have to think about increasing the pH of fly ash. But okay, let us keep this idea. The next slide, how about bottom ash? We tried using bottom ash in making puffing blocks. This is not concrete, but puffing blocks. Applying bottom ash as 10% and 20% of sand showed lower strength as compared to non-bottom ash specimens. However, in some compositions here, bottom ash has the potential to increase the strength. Let's see the right graph. We have investigated that the bottomass can act as the water keeper, like a sponge, because it absorbs water in concrete mixtures. Well, I think it is a good news too. This is the simulations. Bottomass provides internal curing in concrete. And it is simulations we can simulate where bottomass exists in concrete. This is the internal curing effect from bottomass that we expected to occur during the hydration of concrete. It works, as I said before, as a sponge. It absorbs water at the beginning to lower the water to cement ratio at first, but it releases moist gradually at the later age. Let us keep this one as the idea. And next, the next slide. How about the microbes? For microbe selections, obviously, we have to use non-pathogenic aerobic bacteria, so it can work in concrete to fill the pores if the oxygen is excess. So as a concrete containing lime from the cement, so the microbes have to stand high alkalinity. So we isolated the bacteria from lime source, and some pathogenic bacteria do exist in acid conditions. This is why you have to wash your hand with soap to increase the pH to remove the pathogenic bacteria. And this is the reaction. It occurs when we insert the microbes in the concrete. Carbon dioxide from bacteria reacts with the portlandite here to create calcium carbonate precipitated in the concrete pores. Again, the pores becomes denser, and previously it was because of fly ash, but this time it is because of the bacteria. As bacteria has a positive contribution to fill the pores, it releases air, so it helps workability of concrete during casting. However, everybody knows that microbes cannot resist high temperature, so it means that bacteria can be used only in concrete if cement content is reduced or if fly ash is applied. So we have found that some local bacteria in Indonesia can be very much useful to increase the concrete performance. We capture the binary fission of the bacteria in concrete, so to multiply its populations, it does like a binary fission, split itself, and it can live a very long life, even longer than our life. Here we have Bacillus subtilis and Sporosarcina pasturi, and other bacteria is Bacillus stephensis to produce calcite and even aragonite in concrete pores. Aragonite is very hard material and very strong one. And it fills the interfacial transition zone in the concrete, so there is no gap between the aggregates and the concrete matrix. So all the concrete pores were filled with the product of the bacteria. And because it is aerobic, it only can work if the oxygen is exists. It fills the gap everywhere, and even it can heal the cracks in the concrete. So this is the result, the calcium precipitated in the gap. So it closed the gap and healed the cracks. We have fly ash, we have bottomass and bacteria in concrete, But we still need to increase the pH of mixtures because of balancing the pH of concrete plays an important role to increase the concrete performance. SMN usually is high pH around 13 in concrete mixtures. Using fly ash, bedamass, and bacteria can lower the pH in concrete. So what kind of alkali we can use in the fresh concrete? Here, a very light solution of sodium hydroxide is proposed. It can be used as a water replacement to increase the pH in the system. Yes, there is a question. Why alkali does help fly ash in concrete? In a very simple investigation, in 24 hours using a micro camera, we capture the dissolution of fly ash in alkali solutions. You can see the change of particle diameter as the ash is attacked by alkali. This is a proof that fly ash dissolves in alkali system. It becomes more reactive and easy to mix with cement. And in our experiment, we have a schematic reaction during the first hydrations. So this is the simulations. So silicate from fly ash and alkali react together to form albite. So albite is very hard material, like a rock. It is a feldspar materials, and cement and water react together to form calcium silicate hydrate, and its byproduct is calcium hydroxide. We call it portlandite. And the CO2 from bacteria react with the calcium hydroxide to form calcite to fill the pores. And silicate from fly ash react with the remain of calcium hydroxide to form a new calcium silicate hydrate. This is why our concrete pores becomes very dense and filled with the calcium silicate hydrate, the calcite, and albite. And of course, bedamass keeps water and releases the water during the hydration to guarantee the process of the chemical reactions. And this is our experiment. We use a mixed design to obtain the strength of 25 megapascal in 28 days. As a cement replacement, a class F of fly ash was used as like a 30%. 40%, 50% by cement weight. And bedamass was used to replace 10% of sand by weight. And we made a certain sequence of mixing of the materials. It is very important because it will affect the workability of concrete. It will affect also the final strength of the concrete. And we placed fly ash. Then we mix with the sodium hydroxide, then continued with the all aggregates, followed by the cement, and add water-containing superplasticizer in the final mixture. So we have a different superplasticizer content between the non-bacterial mixture here in black, and in red, we have a different superplasticizer content. Why? Because microbes in solution might slightly increase the workability of concrete because it creates air. Now, to make it easier, in all slides, I will make non-bacterial, all non-bacterial in black and all bacterial specimen in red. And specimen with bedamass will be put in blue. This one, we continue, we make a cylindrical specimen for strength test and shrinkage test. We also prepared the cubicle specimens for monitoring the hydrogen temperature in 24 hours after casting, of course. In total, we have 272 specimens. And this is the result. The slum of concrete is very important to observe. As the ice content increases, the water in the mixtures also increase. The ice indeed absorb water during the casting here, and the slum drops. In non-bacterial workability of the mixtures, the slum drops because the fly ash content density is different from the cement. And in bacterial mixtures, the slum increase because the bacteria exits air entrapment in the concrete. It creates air. And this is the result of temperature monitoring during 24-hour hydration. The ash helped to decrease the temperature up to 13%. This is why our bacteria works very well as cement content is reduced. And this is the result. This result is very interesting too. We measure the strain gauge of concrete by putting the strain gauge in the center of specimens. As the content of fly ash increases, we add more water in the mixtures, then the shrinkage increase too. But it is very much surprised to see that specimen with 30% fly ash and specimen containing bottom ash show lower shrinkage than the normal concrete. Why? Maybe this is caused by the ash content and good compacting of the mixtures as well as the effect of the internal curing. And here, at 28 days, concrete with higher fly ash content shows lower compressive strength. It is because of the water demand in concrete also increase. However, at the later age, at 63 days, we found that the increasing rate of strength is higher than the normal specimen. It is very much pleased to see that the effect of internal curing here. Bottom ash works very well as the effect of bacteria to fill the concrete pores by calcite precipitation in concrete pores. And as expected, because of the denser concrete pores, higher split tensile strength shown by specimen containing bacteria and bottom ash, both in 28 days and 63-day specimens, red and blue group are always higher than the black ones. We observe that the microbes build a kind of microfibers inside the concrete. This is why the bacterial specimens show the better tensile than the non-bacterial specimens. Let me show you the SEM analysis of bacteria before. This is before the bare bacteria and after mixing in concrete. The left side here is the bare bacteria. It is a rod shape. So it is just like a rod, very tiny rod. It creates a calcite after mixing with the concrete, while fly ash and sodium hydroxide form albite. This is a very hard material, right? This is just like a rock. Let's see the production in concrete by using XRD analysis. We want to see the mineral composition inside the concrete. This is albite as a product of alumina silicate reactions between sodium hydroxide and fly ash increases the fly ash presence in the mixtures. On the other hand, we can see that there is slightly decrease of portlandite as a product of cement hydration, because it reacted with bacteria and silicate in fly ash to produce new calcium silicate hydrate. So it means that the portland is consumed by bacteria and by fly ash. And the product of bacteria was also found, as we can see here, that there is a calcium carbonate content in the result. We increase our research to the industrial scale in a national project of coal ash utilization. We use fly ash in several power plants in Sumatra Island and Jawa Island during 2017 until last year. It is a collaboration between my university, ITS, and Indonesia Power. We implemented teaching industry to invite industrial partners to join this project. And of course, to consider the cost of concrete, using the sodium hydroxide is not cheap. And we use natural lime to replace the sodium. We use the calcium carbonates powder. And the results are also very good. Fly ash content increase here, the strength drop, of course. Here we can see the effect of using 20% of fly ash and 50% of fly ash containing bottom ash. But the presence of bacteria incorporated with lime can boost the strength in 28 days. The bending test result also shows a very potential, a very good to apply high volume fly ash with bacteria. The microbes over commercially, I'm not the one who made it, but it is our partner and it is not expensive. Compared with superplasticizer, the cost is almost the same. And we have also a project to heal the cracks using bacteria. And this is the result. During 100 days of observations, we found that microbes can heal the cracks by closing the gap. There are two kinds of mechanism. The first one is auto-healing, and the second one is autonomous. Auto-healing is created by the product of pozzolanic reactions between the pozzolan and the cement inside the concrete, and it fills the gap. And autonomous is the process produced by bacteria by precipitation of the calcium in the gap. So gradually it heals the crack. And this is finally, we compare the result of normal strength. And this is the upper side is normal strength and higher compressive strength. We found that there is a decrease of CO2 emissions by 44%. The cost of materials also reduced to 26%. And this is a very good contribution to concrete ready mix. Everyone will be happy because of the reducing of the cost of productions. And of course, to get the carbon credit. And finally, this is our conclusions. As we applied high volume coal ash in the mixtures, we obtained many good results. Even though we have a slightly lower strength, of course we get a lower cost. We get a denser matrix, low hydration temperature, good durability of concrete, better shrinkage, if we control the water content. And of course, the contribution to sustainability of the concrete. And this is the end of my presentation. Thank you very much. And we go back to Andre.
Hey, thank you very much, Dr. Januarti. So before we go to the question and answer session from the audience, I also have some like introduction questions probably from me as well. Yeah. I'm really interested about the application of the microbes, about the bacteria. Mm-hmm. And I want to ask you about I would say it's like a limited applicability. For example, like you say that there is a specific microbes that you found in Indonesia and it's suitable for the mixture. Is it possible to like find it somewhere else? You know, like if we are in Europe, could you find the same species of bacteria or something like that? Do you have anything to say on that?
This is not a very complicated thing. Mm-hmm. Actually, in some countries, they already apply the bacteria to heal the crack or to increase the concrete performance. Of course, because of some reasons, like we cannot send the source in one country to another country because of there are some agreement, and because of that, I cannot get bacteria in Japan, for example, but I can get like a Bacillus subtilis in Indonesia, a local Bacillus subtilis, and this is a very common bacteria, and it can be found in the Kars or Lyme region or river sand, and also Sporosarcina pasteri is also a very common bacteria. So in my last experiment, I used also Bacillus satensis. It is accidentally I found in a fermentation food from Japan.
Okay.
So this is from food, and this is of course it is the non-pathogenic bacteria. So everybody can try any kind of the non-pathogenic bacteria, but the problem is how to provide the nutrition of the bacteria. We cannot use the bare bacteria to just directly apply it in the concrete because it needs food nutrition during its process. So we can collect the spore, not the bacteria, but the spore, and we mix it with the nutrition, the solutions. Usually for the Bacillus subtilis, we use ureatic enzyme. Some people use sugar, a kind of a glucose, natural glucose, or some people can use lactose from milk as the nutrition of the bacteria, and mix together. And actually, I don't know much about its compositions, but the one that I used in my project is already offered commercially. So I just bought it from my partner. So it's a very, very easy one.
Okay, so it's widely available, yeah? Okay. Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah,
And then another question about the self-healing concrete. Have you ever investigated about what's the maximum crack width that it can still heal? You know, because sometimes there must be a limitation. You know, if you have a very large crack, then probably it cannot be healed anymore.
Yes, of course. If the crack is already big, it is not fair for the bacteria. So, bacteria is a very tiny one. Mm-hmm. It has to work a very long, long, long time to heal the cracks. Of course, there is a limitation. First, if we have pozzolanic materials in our concrete, it can heal the crack in 100 days or even a month. If the cracks gap maximum is about 0.3 millimeter.
Okay.
So it means it is a very micro crack. But the problem is sometimes we cannot see the crack. So this is a big problem. If we can see the cracks, it's easy. We just repair it. But the problem is the micro cracks can occur everywhere, and we cannot see that. And lets the bacteria solve the problem. So this is the idea.
Okay, thank you very much. So now let's start with the question from the audience. Mm-hmm. I think you can also see in the panel, there are two questions already. The first question is from Mr. Sofian Susanto. I think it's the same. It was a certain maximum crack with observed and R test performing the yield products. R test performing the yield product. Ah, so after the crack is already like recovered, do you test the recovered one whether it's really reaching the full potential as before or?
Yes, this is very interesting one. Of course, healing the cracks means that we cannot go back to its normal condition, to its initial condition.
Original state, okay.
Yes, yeah, it is very hard. But the idea is how to close the crack to increase the durability of concrete. So to increase the mechanical properties of concrete is impossible, almost impossible. If cracks occur, then we cannot rely on the conditions to improve the conditions. But the problem is how to stop the cracks in order to stop the propagation of the acid, the chloride, for example, or the sulfate to penetrate to the concrete. So it's very important. So the main idea here, how to increase the durability of the concrete to stop the crack propagations. Of course, it is a micro crack. After the healing process, like let's say like 100 days or 200 days, of course we did some observations if the healing materials can perform very well in case stop the moist from outside, and we conducted a kind of permeability test, and we put the healed concrete in the tank containing salt, and then because we are worried if the healed materials cannot work very well, and then the rebars inside the concrete becomes corroded. So we did the test, and the permeability is good. It means that the heal materials can work very well. Of course, it needs time. Like some cracks, the gap is wide, so we can see that. But some cracks gap, maybe it's not wide, but it's very deep. So the healing process can be from outside, from the side, from the upper side, and also from the bottom side. So the mechanism of healing the cracks can be observed not only by using the like a micro camera, but also by using ultrasonic pulse velocity to see if the depth of the crack is already reduced during the healing process. So that's also the main project of our research.
Okay, thank you very much. And now we are moving to the second questions from Mr. Arif Ibowo. 100% of fly ash for high performance concrete, probably HPC, has been introduced in Indonesia, and the COP was also known. What is the COP of, let's say, FC45 for the specifications? And have you researched its durability and the corrosion issues regarding this concrete specification? Thank you.
Yes, 100%. 100% of concrete is called geopolymer. So this is the field of our study also. If we study the mechanism or the properties, chemical properties of fly ash, and compare with chemical properties of cement, there are a lot of difference. For example, cement create binder by hydration process. So the media is the water. But in geopolymer, as cement replaced by 100% fly ash, of course, fly ash cannot react with water. For example, if we just mix fly ash with water, nothing happen. So we need like a high alkali solutions, for example, like a sodium hydroxide in some concentrations. And after mixing with the sodium hydroxide, so we can create a very very good binder. Of course, the quality of fly ash plays an important role. If the fly-ash quality is really bad, for example, the burning process during the coal combustion is very low in temperature. I mean, like there are a kind of boilers in Indonesia. The first one is pulverized coal combustion. It is the best one. And the second one, like circulating fluidicide bed coal combustions. This is the second one where the temperature is lower than the first one. So the product of the coal combustion is totally different. Of course, we need a very good quality of fly ash. So we need to investigate also to the power plant, what kind of boiler they have. And after that, we can make a good geopolymer concrete to replace the conventional concrete. Unfortunately, until now, there is no standard to make geopolymer concrete. Why? Because fly ash is a byproduct, so the quality of fly ash, the properties and characterization of fly ash depends not only on the origin of coal ash, but also of the burning process, the collecting system, and there are so many factors. And as we know, everybody knows that some geopolymer concrete shows a very good performance. For example, it can resist the corrosions. It can stop the chloride ingressions to the concrete. And also it is very good to stop the attack of the sulfate. And I also conducted some experiments to burn the geopolymer concrete. So in about like in 24 hours, we burned the geopolymer concrete at like 800 degrees Celsius, and the remaining strength is still good, like 75% to 80% from the initial strength. So this is a potential material to be used in the specific materials also. Of course, talking about the cost, because of the alkali cost is not cheap, then the final product of a geopolymer is not cheap. Yeah, it is a bit expensive than the conventional one. So I think I can answer Mr. Arif Wibowo's questions. Yeah, we don't have any specifications of this kind of novel concrete. Maybe in the future. In our group, we already make like a mapping of fly ash classifications from Aceh to Papua. So we can understand actually what kind of fly ash is good for geopolymer. What kind of fly ash is not good for geopolymer, just can be used only for high volume fly ash. And even some fly ash cannot be used as MN replacement because its reactivity is very low, and also the particle size is also not good to be used as the cement replacement.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, and we move on to the third question from Alinda Day. Do the bacteria heal both primary and secondary cracks in a structural member? Let's say cracks are of limited width.
Yes, this one, yeah? Yes, of course, as long as the bacteria exists, because the bacteria is aerobic, so it means that if there is no oxygen, so the mechanism, the metabolism of the bacteria will stop. So it means that if the secondary crack occurs, so it reaches the place where the bacteria exists, and the bacteria can, we can say that the bacteria is wake up. Yeah, the bacteria wakes up and then doing some metabolism and increasing the populations and put the calcium precipitation in the pores, and the pores becomes denser, and closing the gap becomes denser, and then there is no oxygen, and after that, the bacteria becomes dormant. So it means that as long as the nutrition is there and the bacteria is good, in good conditions, I mean, there is no like extreme conditions like a fire or like a salt attack, for example. So still the secondary or the next crack can be healed by the bacteria.
Okay. Thank you very much. And then the next question from Oliver Venet Fenvesi. Is there any possibility to use these bacteria to heal cracks in existing concrete structural elements? So in hardened concrete, like an existing building, probably, yeah?
Yes, yeah, it can. Because how about the existing concrete already hardened and the cracks occur, and we want to heal the cracks. We can put the bacteria in solutions inside the gap, and after that, we can give the nutritions to the bacteria, like once a week, or just continuously giving the nutritions to the bacteria. So of course, if the conditions available for the bacteria, of course, there is no extreme temperature for the bacteria. So of course, the heals will occur. But still depends on the size of the crack. If the crack is not so big, and then between 28 days or 2 months, the cracks can heal. Of course, this is a very small crack. Or for the big crack that the widely we can see, obviously we can see, so it takes a longer time to heal the crack. It is reported also in some countries. I think Delft University also already reported the kind of the research. We did also in our project. Yeah. Yeah, it's possible.
Okay. It's possible. So, yeah, this is another interesting question. How do we measure a percentage or like concentration of bacteria, and is there a limitation that makes bacteria like something this effect is like a threat to concrete by overly self-healing and expanding, causing more cracks?
Okay.
Is there any possibility like that?
Yeah, of course. If the population of the spore we put in the concrete is too small, and then there is no meaning of bacteria to heal the cracks. For example, the one that I already presented here is talking about high performance concrete using bacteria. We didn't use too much bacteria population inside the mixtures. For example, we only used like a half liter bacteria, including the nutrition. So it's kind of solutions, the spore inside the solutions, including the nutritions. So half 0.5 liter per cubic meter is enough to increase the concrete performance. But to heal the cracks, of course, this dosage is not enough. We need to put more bacteria, for example, like a double, or like 1 liter or 2 liters bacteria per cubic meter. So to make it fast, just not to increase the concrete performance, but also to heal the cracks. We need more populations because the product of bacteria is CO2. We need more CO2 reacted with the calcium hydroxide to make a calcite precipitations in the gap of the crack.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you. And then another question from Sofian Susanto. If not mistaken, it was mentioned that bottom ash could lower a certain temperature. Would it affect bacteria survivability rate since it cannot withstand high temperature? And how long can a bacteria lie dormant?
Yeah, very interesting questions. Both fly ash and bottom ash can be used to decrease the hydration temperature. But in case of the Batamas, it reacts or it has two tasks. The first is to decrease the temperature, and the second one to be a water storage. So both of them are useful, but they have a different function in concrete hydration. And of course, bacteria cannot survive if the cement content is very high. So we need to decrease the amount of cement. Of course, decreasing the amount of cement means we can decrease the strength of concrete. So in order to increase the strength of the concrete, of course, we need to boost the reactivity of fly ash. So that's why we use the sodium hydroxide, or we use lime to increase the pozzolanicity of fly ash. So we will get like a double product. Like we have a durable concrete, we have a denser pores, and also we have a lower hydration. This is a very much difficult during hot weather concreting, especially in Indonesia and tropical country, because on the road the temperature is very high. So the cracks because of the hydration temperature is always occur. So because of that, using bacteria is a very good potential in the future, together with the high volume coal ash, not only fly ash, but also Batamas. Actually, in Indonesia, everybody don't want to use Batamas. As a result, in the power plant, Andri, fly ash is easy to be used. But Batamas is just like a stepson or stepdaughter. Nobody wants it. So, in order to utilize more coal ash to clean our power plant, to learn like other countries, we need to utilize it as much as possible. So that's why we propose to use Batamas as the sand replacement. Remember, we cannot replace Batamas as a main replacement, but we can replace Batamas as the sand replacement. Thank you, Mr. Sofian, for your questions.
And then there is one there. How long can a bacteria lie dormant? Is there any...
Oh yeah, dormant. Yes. Some research reported that the bacteria can have a very long life, like 100 years. Yeah. So it's like an ancient bacteria, especially Bacillus sp or Sporus arcana. It can have a very long life. I cannot prove that, of course. First, because of the limitation of the duration of the research. And the second one, because of course, my student cannot handle that. So at least like 1 year or more than 1 year, we can find that the bacteria population still increasing. And it means that it can adapt with the conditions in the concrete. So of course there are some limitations to prove this kind of the questions, but at least the bacteria can lie dormant if there is no food, if there is no oxygen. But if there is oxygen, if there is a gap and there is a nutrition for the bacteria, for the bacteria, of course it can wake up and then works again.
Okay, and then there is one last question from Ari Fibowo. This Bacillus bacteria, can it be found easily in Indonesia, and whether it's hazardous for human? Does it require like special treatment or health protocol to use it?
Okay, so I hope that kind of bacteria is just like Yakult. It can be used for our health. It can be used for concrete health. But of course, as I discussed before that in my slide, that this kind of bacteria should be non-pathogenic bacteria. This is a must. because it's going to be applied in industrial scale, it's going to be used by everybody, of course it should be non-pathogenic bacteria. So we have to test it, and there are kind of special tests to check the compositions of the solutions, including the bacteria. So the one that we use in our project is safe, so it is okay, no problem. And of course it can be found easily in Indonesia, as I told before. It can be found everywhere, in soil, in river sand, but the problem is how to create the nutritions of the bacteria. So we have to collaborate with microbiologist people or biochemistry, expert in biochemistry, to create the nutritions of the bacteria, because without the nutrition, we cannot use it in the concrete. Yeah, so that's my answer. And there is special required treatment. We just put it in the ambient temperature. We don't need to put it in the refrigerator or in cooler temperature. No, just in tropical temperature. It is okay.
Okay, thank you very much. I think we already answered all the questions. Just to close this Q&A session, what's next, Dr. Gennardi? I mean, what will be the future research in this topic from your research group, for example? What will be the objective?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, of course, this kind of bacteria, this kind of project is a potential, especially in the past, you know, like Indonesia regulations consider bottom ash and coal ash as the hazardous material. So somehow it is very funny. While in other country, fly ash and bottom ash are utilized as much as possible. But fortunately, just last month, congratulations to Indonesian government, we become very smart that fly ash and bottom ash now is not considered as the hazardous material anymore. So it means that there are a lot of potential to utilize coal ash as much as possible. Of course, there are some limitation, there are some worries that using fly ash and bottom ash can be bad to the concrete mixtures because of the color. Sometimes people judge the beauty by its color, so it's not fair. And we can utilize this bacteria to boost the performance of the concrete. That's the first one. And the second one for our next project, of course, as the archipelago country, we have a lot of structure need to be maintained because of the corrosions occur, especially structure in the offshore or very close to the beach, very close to the sea environment, where the chloride penetration is severe, not only because of the global warming, but also because of the, you know, the rising of sea level. And we have to find in the future a kind of bacteria that can resist salt conditions. Of course, we use like a salt in a normal bacteria, the bacteria will die because it cannot resist the salt. But kind of the special bacteria, of course, it should be isolated from the sea environment. We cannot isolate the bacteria from the mountain or the lime area, but we have to find it. We have to isolate it from the sea environment, maybe from the coral, or from the sea sand. We have to find the bacteria, non-pathogenic one, and then find the nutrition, and we can mix the concrete to against the sea environment in the future. That's our next project. Thank you very much, Andre.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Januarti Jayaka Putri. So I will formally close this Q&A session, and representing the FIB and FIB Young Members Group, you would like to thank for your sharing this evening. It was like amazing, and we had a very nice discussion and presentation session this evening, which gives us a lot of knowledge and experience from you. So it's very nice. And I would like to thank also all the FIB secretariat, Corinne, Marie, and David, and for all the participants who attend this webinar session. So yeah, I will close this webinar session and see you in the next or in the next event. Thank you very much. Good evening.
Yeah, see you. Thank you.